Okay, so we were looking at a few different kinds of latch configurations and how those can in turn be used in order to create edge triggered flip-flops, right? So what we are going to do now is get a little bit more into detail on what are the timing parameters, and in particular, how do you do timing analysis on a large circuit? Okay, what does it mean to do timing analysis? How do you find out the maximum speed at which a circuit can work? What are the issues that come up over there, right? So before getting into that, I just wanted to also very briefly touch upon how do you measure something like the setup and hold time. Okay, so you have already done some SPICE simulations for an inverter where you go through and sort of estimate the propagation delay through the inverter, right? How do you do that? You essentially set up a chain of inverters and say that, okay, one particular inverter is driving a load, right? You control the load, you control the input slew, and under those conditions you can sort of say what is the delay through that inverter going to be. Okay, the further assignments also have something similar to do along those lines. Okay, the question is, that is a relatively straightforward thing, right? You give it an input, you see when the output happens, then the output actually changes, you mark the 50% transition point at the input, you mark the 50% transition point at the output, and you are done. You can basically measure the time gap between them and say this is the propagation delay through the inverter. Okay, clock to output delay for a flip-flop is something similar, right? I can essentially apply an input, right, which is different from the current value of the flip-flop. After it has had some time to stabilize, I change the clock. I give it a positive edge or negative edge as the case may be, and I measure how much time after that clock has transitioned does it take before the output actually transitions. Okay, so measuring TCQ, in other words, is fairly straightforward. Okay, so the question becomes, how do you measure something like setup time and hold time? Because those are not just numbers that you can mark on the SPICE plots, right? I can't say that, oh, okay, look, this is where the clock transitioned. From this point onwards, if the data had changed, how do you know that? At which point should you sort of say, you know, the data is not allowed to change here or it can cause problems? Okay, so how is this done in practice? Well, let's look at two parts of it. One is, from the circuit level structure, can we estimate what the setup time or hold time or TCQ are going to be? But these estimates are going to be very rough and not very accurate. It only gives you an idea of what are the factors that influence the setup time, TCQ, and so on. Okay, then we'll look at how do you actually do SPICE simulations, and that will be part of one of your assignments coming up later. Okay, so let's just look at a situation where I'm trying to implement something like this. Supposing this is one configuration that I am using, right? It's okay. Okay. Okay, this is one possibility. I'm not saying that this is necessarily optimal or that, you know, this is the best possible structure for a flip-flop. You can look at other alternatives. In particular, what you might find over here is that there are too many inverters in one chain going through from input to output, right? Is there some way that you can reduce those? Is there some way that you can reduce that path directly going through? There are a number of optimizations that you can think of in terms of a circuit like this, right? But given a circuit of this sort, the question becomes, can we now estimate what is going to be the TCQ, T setup, and so on? Okay? So keep in mind, these are very rough estimates. These are just sort of based on what are the minimum requirements that I can put in order to say, okay, this is going to be the minimum TCQ, or, you know, this is going to be an approximate value for the TCQ. Okay? I'm just sort of grouping things together as large chunks and seeing, okay, can I add up the delays through them? Okay? In order to get a real value for TCQ, you would need to do a spice simulation. In fact, this is probably more essential for something like a flip-flop than even for an inverter. An inverter has a relatively simple structure, right? There is just a little bit which involves, you know, couple of transistors, and you can sort of estimate what is the equivalent resistance and therefore the delay through it. In this case, it's a lot more. There are a number of basic gates that are used in order to construct a flip-flop, okay? So how does this behave, right? The first part that we have is when C is equal to 0, right, this initial feedback loop is operational, okay? Then when C becomes equal to 1, right, what happens is the beta goes through and comes until X, okay? It cannot go any further than this, okay? Yeah, okay, it doesn't really matter. The normal configuration would probably be to put the transmission gate in a slightly different place, but it doesn't matter, right? I mean, we are just looking at whether we can understand what happens over here. Now, when C is equal to 1, in other words, the data comes through until the point X, okay? After that, when C becomes equal to 0, so in other words, what kind of flip-flop, what kind of edge is this triggering on, this structure? Is it a positive edge or a negative edge? In this case, it's negative edge, right? The first latch is transparent when C is equal to 1. The second one is transparent when C is equal to 0, okay? So the transition from 1 to 0 is when the data will come through to the output. Therefore, it's a negative edge triggered flip-flop, okay? So what we are saying is when C is equal to 1, the data can come through until X and will sort of stop over there, right? It cannot proceed any further because that first transmission gate is off. Right? At the transition, that is when the clock changes, right? What will happen to it? Yeah, in fact, I think that... What is it? Yeah. Correct. So this will actually cause a little bit of a problem as far as this circuit is concerned. Let me just modify this slightly. Okay. I'll push the transmission gates to the lower portion just for, you know, clarity over here. Because otherwise there's one small problem that arises. Okay, so what I'm saying in other words is, in which case this also changes, when C is equal to 1, what will happen is the data will go through the first inverter, the first transmission gate, the second inverter, and the third inverter, and will come all the way up till here. Okay. What do I mean by it will come up till here? The point is it cannot get through the second transmission gate, right? Because that transmission gate is now off, okay? So it reaches up to this point. It will also reach up to this point, but get blocked over here, okay? So there is one x over here, and I'll call this point y. So it reaches both x and y. Okay, but the data is not allowed to go any further than that. After that, once the clock edge transitions, right, when c becomes equal to 1, what we will see is the feedback loop kicks in. This becomes transparent and also goes through until this point. Yeah, sorry, when c is equal to 0, right? So the first part is when c is equal to 1, the red curve essentially shows that is when the data is sort of getting pulled into the flip-flop. Okay, it has not yet made its way through to the output. This is the setup portion. Okay, it has to go and it has to make sure that it is available at all the points in the loop, so that as and when the loop gets closed, it will properly stabilize to one of the logic values and not to a metastable state. Okay, then when the c becomes equal to 0, from wherever the data is available right now, it has to make its way through to the output. Okay, given that amount of information, what would you say is the TCQ of this flip-flop, the clock to Q output delay? What would determine the clock to Q output delay of this edge triggered flip-flop? Right? So essentially what we are saying is, this blue curve, the delay from Y to Q, is primarily what is going to determine my clock to Q output delay, because the data has already reached Y before the clock changes. Okay, it might have reached well before, it might have reached 1 nanosecond, 2 nanoseconds, 5 nanoseconds before, but it doesn't matter, it cannot cross this transmission gate T3. Right? It cannot cross T3 until the clock becomes equal to 0. Okay, so it waits at Y until the clock becomes equal to 0. As soon as the clock becomes equal to 0, the data starts going through. From Y, it crosses T3. So there will be some delay associated with that. Transmission gates also have a certain delay. Right? Why is that? Because they can essentially be thought of as some kind of equivalent resistance. And their drain capacitance will be there going to ground. Okay, so it will be like an RC equivalent network that you have over there. Okay? That in turn goes through an inverter, so there is an inverter delay which comes after that. So in other words, what happens finally is that TCQ is approximately going to be equal to delay through T3 plus the delay through I5. Okay, the fact that D had to go through I1, T1, I2 and so on in order to get to this point does not matter, because all of that happened before the clock edge. Okay, we are only interested in once the data is ready to get captured, or rather ready to come through to the output, how long does it take after the clock edge for the data to come through. Okay, so if you want to do a rough estimate of what is the delay through this flip-flop TCQ, this is one way by which you can estimate it. Okay, now what about setup time? Setup time is slightly more tricky to understand, but what you need to think about is this. Look at the first feedback loop, right, the left hand side, right? So in other words, I2, T3, T2, okay? Sorry, I2, I3, T2. So what we have is, I will call this point, let's say Z, okay? So I have the two sides of T2, right? What are the values that are being seen on those? T2, one side is Z, the other side is X. Okay? What happens when C becomes equal to 0? T2 turns on, right? And the feedback loop is closed. Okay. So if you think about it, in order to avoid metastability, what must be the condition that I satisfy? At the point where I am closing T2 and activating the feedback, if I have different values at X and Z, there is a chance that I can run into a problem. Okay? If the values at X and Z are different, then they will start sort of competing. One will be pulling towards 0, the other will be pulling towards 1. There is a chance that I can get stuck in the metastable intermediate state, and then there is no guarantee on how long it will take me to get out of that. Okay? So in order to avoid that, what do I need to do? I need to make sure that the value at X and the value at Z are the same. Okay? How can I guarantee something like that? Say that before the clock edge arrives, right, before T2 turns on, I need to make sure that D, whatever input I am providing, is able to come all the way till X. Okay? Because it has already passed through Z, in the process of getting through to X, it has passed through Z. I now need to make sure it has also reached X. Once it reaches X, it means that the values at Z and the value at X are the same. I activate the feedback loop, there will be no metastability problem. Okay? So from the point of view of setup time, all that I need to make sure of is, before the clock edge arrives, the data from D must have reached all the way till X. Okay? So I can estimate my setup time as essentially delay through I1 plus delay through T1 plus delay through I2 plus delay through I3. Okay. So this essentially tells me, as long as I satisfy this condition, as long as I leave this much margin, right, the clock is going to change at some instant of time. Let's say that this T setup, this total time when I add it up together, turns out to be 1 nanosecond, right? I need to make sure that at least that time of the clock, 1 nanosecond before that, I stop changing D. D is not allowed to change any further. Okay? As long as I can guarantee something of that sort, right? It means that I will not have a problem where X and Z have different values at the time when the clock changes. So this is sort of a good safety margin to put for me, and this is an approximate value for my setup time. Okay. Last question, what about the hold time? Right? Now if you look carefully at the hold time, what is happening over here is, how does the structure work? Assume non-overlapping, you know, that the clocks are not overlapping, let's not have any issues with C bar both equal to 1 or 0 and so on. Let's leave that aside. Right? If we assume that the clocks themselves are ideal, right, then what happens over here is, what do I mean by hold time? I am essentially saying that after the clock edge has changed, that is the clock has gone from 1 to 0, right, is there any chance that a change in D can make its way through to the output? Okay. Now look at what happens over here, right? When the clock changes from 1 to 0, the first thing that happens is T1 turns off. Any further change in D is blocked right there. Okay, it cannot even make its way into the master latch. Okay, so effectively what we are saying, in other words, is for a flip-flop which is built like this, the hold time is 0. Because as soon as the clock changes, right at the input of the master latch itself, we are preventing any data from coming inside. Okay. So in a master slave configuration, in other words, it is possible to get hold time of 0. Right? Now in practice, you might have some other issues, which might be because of the fact that there might be some delay with which the clock itself arrives. Right? How are you providing the clock to those transmission gates? There might be some sort of wiring delay or a buffer delay on that line. Right? As a result, you might end up with a situation where the hold time becomes non-zero, we will look at, you know, how the hold time can be computed in such a situation with another example later. But on the face of it, it is possible to construct master slave configurations with essentially zero hold time. Okay, so what is the purpose of all of this? It's essentially saying, look, if you know the transistor level structure of a flip flop, you can estimate what the TCQ, T setup, and T hold are going to be. Okay, these are not very accurate for a number of reasons. I have just written things like, you know, delay through I1, delay through T1, and so on. Right? It's not as though the delay through the inverter or delay through a transmission gate is a fixed number. That itself depends on a number of things, including whether it's a 0 to 1 transition or a 1 to 0 transition, right? What is the previous value over there? Okay. What is the slew at the input? What is the final load that it's connected to? So a number of other issues come in, which I have conveniently ignored over here. The goal was only to give you a rough idea of what are all the things that can influence the TCQ and the T setup. Okay. So if we have all of that, the next question that comes is, how can we actually measure this in a simulation? Okay, and typically what is done in the case of simulation is to say, this is my, you know, top level, high level schematic of the circuit that I want to test. This is my edge triggered flip flop. Okay, what I will do is, I will simulate a condition where, in this case, it's a positive edge triggered flip flop. So I will simulate a condition where C goes from 0 to 1. Okay. And I will take D and also give a transition, let's say either from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0. I actually need to check both cases. Right. But it has to be a transition. D has to change. At some time interval T, just before the clock edge. Okay. So in other words, what I'm doing is I'm making D transition somewhere close to the clock edge. Right? But by itself, the question is, okay, what does that tell me? Does that straight away tell me that, you know, this is the setup time? No, because I don't know at which point I'm running into problems. Okay. But what you will encounter in such a situation is, what you can measure is that when D changes like this, what you expect from Q is that Q also changes. This TQ is a measurable delay. You can actually mark off the points on the simulation and measure how much is that delay. This is a computed value. The distance from D to C is something that is your input. You are changing it. You are controlling when D changes. Right? The TQ is something that is a measured value that actually depends on how the simulation goes. Okay? Now, typically what you will observe is, if I start off with D changing, the value of T being large. Right? Small t is large. In other words, D changes well before the clock. Okay? You will find that the TQ is pretty much a constant value. It is determined probably by something like what you saw over here, maybe the T3 plus I5 or something like that. Okay, there will be some value over here which determines the value of TQ. Okay, but as T becomes smaller and smaller, right, what happens when T becomes smaller and smaller? Essentially, we are reaching a situation where that feedback loop is not really getting established properly. That in turn will affect how quickly the output can transition. Okay? And it can be observed at the output as a change in the propagation delay, change in TQ. Okay? So as T becomes smaller, you will find that at some point TQ starts becoming larger. Okay? At which point you can put some kind of a threshold and say, if my TQ increases by either 20% or 50% or some number that you choose for characterization, right, we will say that is unacceptable. Right? I do not want my output delay to increase by more than 20% or more than 50%. Okay? And whatever is the value of T which gives you that much increase in output delay, you call that your setup time. Okay. So in other words, you do a series of simulations. You start off with a large value of t, the t input changing well before the clock, move it closer and closer to the clock in some steps, and as it gets closer, you will find that slowly at some point the delay starts increasing. Okay. You put some threshold on that increase and say, okay, how much is allowed to increase? If it increases by more than so much, I will consider it unacceptable and freeze it at this point and say, whatever was the t that I saw there, that is my setup time. I need to make sure that my data stabilizes at least that much time before the clock. Okay. You can do the same thing on the other side of the clock, right? You start changing d just after the clock. You will find that possibly the tq again becomes larger compared to what it is at distant values, right? Or rather that it at least changes, right? You don't want it to change. Anytime after the clock, you actually don't want the output to change. As you sort of increase it a bit further, you'll find that once t has become sufficiently large beyond the clock on the other side, the transition that you are putting over here will not even be seen at the output. Okay? So the whole time essentially says what is that value, that delay that you need to give to prevent the transition from being seen at the output. Okay? So setup time and hold time, in other words, can be sort of empirically measured from the SPICE equivalent of the circuit. Okay? We'll have an assignment on that coming up later, so you can actually do this. Like I said, one of the things that you also have to do is characterize a complete cell. Right? This will be part of everyone's assignment. All of you need to implement a flip-flop at the transistor level, do the layout, extract it, and characterize for TCQ, T-setup, and hold. Okay. Apart from that, you will also be picking some cells from a standard cell library. We will give you a little bit more details about what are the issues in standard cell design, probably in a couple of classes time. And then you need to start picking which cells you are going to implement and characterize. Okay. What do I mean by the word characterize? Essentially what I am saying is, you know, find out all its parameters. Okay. So for an inverter, for example, right? What is the area? How tall is it? How wide is it? Right? So what is the area that it occupies? Right? What is the propagation delay for 0 to 1, for 1 to 0, for different values of input slew and output load? Right? So you'll essentially get a two-dimensional lookup table which says if the input slew is around this much and the output load is this much, this will be the delay. If the input slew is this much and the output load is this much, this will be the delay, and so on. Okay? Similarly, you can also do a power estimate. Once again, depending on the input slew and the output load, you will get different values of power consumption, the dynamic or switching active, switching power for each transition, a 0 to 1 or a 1 to 0 transition at the gate. Okay? All of that, once you find out all those numbers and put them in a formal document, that is essentially called a characterization of that cell. Okay? Standard cells typically are characterized by whoever it is who is providing the service to you, who is providing the fabrication or foundry service, right? So they will typically say, okay, we have a foundry where we can actually build chips. For this particular foundry, these are the feature sizes. These are recommended standard cells that you can use. And you build your design around those cells. Okay? So what you will be doing is essentially designing something which could be potentially standard cells used in a design of that sort. Okay? Alright. So, like I said, the next topic, moving on over here, is related to this. It's essentially a question of how do we do timing analysis? Okay? So, what does it mean to talk about timing analysis? How do we do it for more complex circuits? How do we find out the maximum speed at which a given circuit can operate? Okay? So, the first thing that we have is let's consider a very basic circuit structure. I have a flip-flop, edge-triggered flip-flop. I have some combinational logic. And I have another flip-flop over here. Okay? There's a clock which feeds both the flip-flops. There are some inputs over here, some outputs over here. Okay. The first thing that I can say is, for this path between these two flip-flops, right, what is the path taken by the data as it goes through from one set of flip-flops to the other, or rather from the first flip-flop to the second one, right? What happens is, I assume that my data is already stable at the input to start with, and then a clock edge arrives. Okay, what happens when the clock edge arrives? There will be some time for the data to come out of the flip-flop. That is my TCQ. Okay, then I will have some delay through the combinational logic, and finally I will have some guard margin that I need to put at the other end, which is the setup time, right? And all of this must happen, essentially what we are saying is, the data must be ready at the input of the second flip-flop before the next clock edge arrives over there. Okay, now the notion of a clock is that it is a regularly spaced square wave, right? So in other words, a square wave of a fixed frequency. Whether it has 50% duty cycle or not is actually not relevant for us, because in this kind of a circuit we are only concerned with the possible edges of the clock. Okay, the duty cycle may play a role, for example, if you are using master slave configurations, right? If the duty cycle is very small, you might find that it is actually not able to go through one stage of the flip-flop and so on. We'll ignore that. We'll assume for the time being at least that we are working with close to 50% duty cycle, so that kind of thing is not an issue. Okay. So now what can we say with this? Essentially what we are saying is, this delay TCQ plus the combinational delay plus the setup time, all of these put together must be less than the clock time period. Okay. If it is not, then you are likely, then you will end up with some kind of a timing violation at the input of the second flip-flop. Okay. What kind of timing violation? If it turns out that the left-hand side is greater than T clock, then most probably you are ending up with a setup violation, right? So far we are only talking about setup constraints, right? In other words, the data has to be ready before the clock edge, right? So this is one set of constraints which needs to be satisfied. Okay, I can do this for every path in a circuit which starts at a flip-flop and ends at another flip-flop. Okay, so if I have a large circuit, hundreds of flip-flops, thousands of gates, right? I need to find every possible combination between which starts at one flip-flop and ends at another flip-flop, take every single path which can go through between those, write down constraints for this, and choose a T clock which satisfies every one of those constraints. Okay? That is precisely how T clock needs to be computed. In practice, of course, you don't need to go and enumerate every single pair of flip-flops and every combinational path between them. There are ways of doing it in a more clever fashion. But the bottom line is that this is what you are doing. You are effectively making sure that every pair of flip-flops, these conditions are satisfied. Okay? Now, one related thing, when I write this value T cone com, the combinational logic over here, right? What I mean is the maximum delay through the combinational logic. Okay? In other words, for whatever, even the worst case through a gate, let's say it's a NAND gate, right? There are three possibilities for 0 to 1 transition, another three for 1 to 0 transition at the output, right? Whichever is the worst of those delays, I need to take and put that into my combinational delay calculation. Okay? So that's actually how I need to compute this. Now, the other side of it is, so far there is nothing has come up with regard to the hold time. So the question becomes, is hold time even relevant? Why do I need to bother about it? Okay. So as far as that is concerned, we still need to satisfy one more condition, which is that what happens to the data when the clock changes? It goes through the first flip-flop. It takes a delay equal to TCQ. right? It goes through the combinational logic. I'll again write tcom, but now I'm going to write min to indicate that it's the minimum delay through the combinational logic. Okay, what does that mean? It essentially means the minimum propagation delay that has some kind of transition associated with it. Okay, so in the case of a NAND gate, for example, right, what I can just off the top of my head assume is that the condition where both the inputs go to 0, 0, right, that essentially causes both the PMOS to be turned on, right? The current that is available for pull up is more than if any one of them alone is on, but the sizing I chose was that even if one of them is on, it matches the delay corresponding to the regular inverter. So if both are on, then I can assume that the delay will be even less. Okay, that is an example of minimum delay. So most likely for a two input NAND gate, the minimum delay will correspond to the point where both inputs go to 0, right? Both inputs are initially 1 and then both go to 0, so that both PMOS turn on, start delivering current and charge the output. Okay, that's one possibility. Okay, what I'm saying is that minimum delay, right, essentially what it's saying is after TCQ, the output of the first flip-flop has changed. After another TCOM min, it has reached the input of the second flip-flop, right? I do not want it to go through the second flip-flop, right? Because any change that happens at the first flip-flop should be reflected at the second flip-flop only after one clock cycle. I do not want data to go through two flip-flops in one clock cycle. Okay? So to prevent that, I need to make sure that this number is greater than or equal to the whole time. So what does that mean? It means that so much time after the clock edge, the data should not change at the input of the second flip-flop. Okay, so that essentially is the meaning of the whole time. Note this equation carefully. There is no mention of T clock over here. Okay, so the whole time constraint, in other words, has no influence on the clock period, right? There is also another side to it. What that means is, look at the previous equation, right? What it's telling you is that condition needs to be satisfied, right? What's the simplest way to make sure that it is always satisfied, no matter what the values of TCQ, TCOM, and so on are? How can I always guarantee that it will be satisfied? Which of these parameters is in my control? The clock cycle, right? TCQ is a property of the flip-flop. TCOM is a property of the combinational logic. T setup is a property of the flip-flop. T clock is something I am applying as a user, not even as a designer, right? So the simplest way for me to make sure that all setup time constraints are satisfied is to say I will operate with an even slower clock, which means a longer time period. Okay, you are not sure whether setup time is 1 nanosecond or 2 nanoseconds, fine, make the clock period 10 nanoseconds, 20 nanoseconds, 30 nanoseconds, whatever, make it sufficiently large that you don't have any confusion at all. Okay, so in other words, by choosing a large enough value of T clock, I can guarantee that my setup time constraints across the board can always be satisfied. Okay, I do not have such a condition for the second constraint. TCQ, TCOM minimum and T hold are all properties of the circuit elements. Okay, if any one of them, or rather if this condition is not satisfied, I don't have any external control which will allow me to fix that problem. Okay, so on the face of it, this equation is, you know, you look at the numbers and probably it's going to be easier to satisfy. Why? Because we already saw that for a master slave, T hold is either 0 or close to 0. Okay, T comp minimum will be some small value, but it will still be a non-zero value. Okay, and TCQ also will have some value associated with it. So pretty much all that I need to make sure of is that TCQ is larger than T hold. Okay, if I can guarantee that for a flip-flop, then I don't really have any issues after that. okay, but I need to be able to guarantee that. Because if I cannot do it, then my final circuit, there is no way that I can fix it. If I have a hold time violation somewhere, right, there is no way that I can really fix this problem. Okay. Now, let's complicate this picture slightly by seeing a slightly more realistic scenario, right? Over here, I have assumed sort of an ideal clock, right? Where exactly the same clock, the clock edge arrives at both the flip-flops at exactly the same time. In practice, that will never be the case, okay? What will happen is, you will have a circuit like this. Clock will arrive here at some time instant. Clock will arrive here after some delay. Okay, let's call that delay S, right? This is usually called the clock skew. Okay, what does skew mean? It essentially means a slight offset between two objects, right? In this case, we are talking about the clock at the first flip-flop and the clock at the second flip-flop, and saying that they are skewed slightly with respect to each other. Okay, so what does that skew mean? It essentially says that they do not occur at exactly the same time instant. They occur maybe a few picoseconds apart, right? Clock skew could be small. Typically, it will be pretty small. It will be in the picoseconds range, depending on your technology, of course, right? But your goal, obviously, would be to ideally have clock skew zero, because that's what gives you the confidence that this is a proper synchronous circuit, that you don't need to worry about anything else after that, right? But if you cannot get the clock skew equal to zero, the question becomes, how do those two inequalities that we wrote down, how do they change, right? So these are the two inequalities, right? One for the setup time, one for the hold time. How should they change if there is a clock skew between the two clocks? Okay, how? Add S to the right hand side, right? So essentially what we are saying is this. What we are saying is, okay, if I call this C1 and I call this C2, I'm saying C1 looks something like this, C2 looks like this, right? And this is S, okay? Which means that the second transition on C1 happens here, the second transition on C2 happens here, okay? So initially, let's say this was my time 0, this is S, this is T, and this is T plus S, okay? My first constraint that I have over here, TCQ plus TCOM plus T setup, right, must happen before the clock arrives at the second flip-flop. When does the clock arrive at the second flip-flop? At T plus S, okay? So TCQ plus TCOM maximum plus T setup must be less than or equal to T clock plus S. Okay? So if you look at it in terms of the constraints, this is actually helping you. Right? It means that on my right hand side, I have one term S which is already contributing something positive. So I could choose a slightly lower value of T clock and still get the correct behavior. In other words, no violation of a timing constraint. What about hold time? Is that also something I need to worry about? What was it that I wrote down for the second equation? Data comes out of the first flip-flop, goes through the combinational logic, should not change before the clock edge plus hold time. Same clock edge. Right? Once again, I have a plus S on the right hand side. Well, on the left hand side. Right? So what I have in other words is, for the hold time, this is my TCQ. Plus the minimum combinational logic delay, right? This is the time at which the data changes at the input of the second flip-flop. When does the clock change at the input of the second flip-flop? At time S. Up to what time should I make sure that it should not change? Up to S plus HD. At S plus hold. Okay? So previously I just had that the left hand side TCQ plus minimum T combinational delay should be greater than the hold time of the second flip flop. Now I am saying it must be greater than the hold time from the time that the clock actually arrives at the second flip flop. The clock arrives at the second flip flop at time S. From there I need to give an additional T hold, and that condition needs to be satisfied. Okay? This has become harder to satisfy, because now it means that my TCQ and TCOM minimum have to be made even bigger. Okay? Where would such a situation really become a problem? One place where hold time constraints are a very real issue is if I have something like a shift register. What is the combinational logic delay here? Zero. Okay. So all I have over here is TCQ and I have a T hold on the other side. So effectively what I mean is TCQ must be greater than T hold. If there is a clock skew also, T hold plus S. Okay. So effectively this becomes a harder constraint to satisfy, right? Especially if there is a clock skew, and if the clock skew increases, it becomes more and more difficult to satisfy it. Okay? That is one part of the story. So how do you fix something of this sort? Pretty much the only way that you can do it is, what do you have control over? You can't change the flip-flop. You cannot change TCQ, you cannot change T-hold. You may be able to change T-comb, you may be able to change S. Okay? As far as TCOM is concerned, the simplest way of changing it is to say I will add some kind of a delay, a fixed delay. What is the simplest way of adding a fixed delay? Some kind of a buffer circuit. What does a buffer look like in practice? The simplest way of inverting it of implementing it in CMOS is two inverters. Okay? So you use two inverters, they implement a buffer. That adds some amount of combinational logic delay. And I can make sure that my left hand side will become greater than my right hand side. The other possibility is, I can try to make S negative. How do I make S negative? Reverse the direction of the clock, right? Give the clock first to the second flip-flop and then to the first flip-flop. I mean, I'm calling it first and second because of the way I drew it, right? That is just a question of knowing in which direction is the data traveling and in which direction is the clock traveling. If they're going in opposite directions, that helps you as far as your hold time constraints are concerned. Okay? So, fixing hold time constraints, in other words, essentially requires putting in all these buffers and other kinds of things in order to fix paths. Fixing setup time constraints is relatively easier. You just increase the clock period. Okay? We'll go through a more detailed analysis of an example in the next class. We'll stop here.